During the early 1800s, various fur companies like the Hudson Bay Company and the American Fur Company hired adventurous, hardy men to trek into the western wilderness and trap beaver. At the time, the tall beaver hat was the fashion rage in Europe, which made beaver pelts a premium market item. The problem was in transporting the beaver pelts to market and keeping the mountain man trapper outfitted with supplies. The nearest market point was St. Louis, and the journey between the high mountain trapping grounds and St. Louis was a long, arduous, and oftentimes risky journey. The fur companies, in order to develop a more efficient system, packed up wagon trains with supplies, then caravaned into a centrally located area within the mountains, where all the trappers would convene, trade in their furs, and renew their much-needed supplies. Thus was born the Mountain Man Rendezvous. When considering the rugged, solitary life led by these mountain men for most of the year, one can only imagine all the eventful doings that must have taken place at these annual rendezvous. By 1843, the fashions had changed. The market for beaver pelts totally dried up. Sadly, the era of the rendezvous ended. It was a short-lived time in American history, but a time packed full of heroic deeds, wonderful discoveries, and fantastic tales. Today, the heritage and nostalgia of those exciting years lives on in the modern rendezvous. Each year, one is held during the first week in April at the site of the old Fort Washita in southern Oklahoma. Here, one can go back in time and perhaps relive the memories of the mountain man, of such legends as Jim Bridger, Hugh Glass, Jed Smith, Joe Meek, and Kit Carson. What better way to enjoy and appreciate an important part of our American history?
My elk rifle. I'm gonna take that to Colorado and shoot a big elk with it. See the big hole in the front?
Oh, that's beautiful.
58 caliber, is. Jaeger. Well, when I was thinking about getting a gun built, I had to have something with a short barrel because I hunt with mules and they're kind of short. I either had to get a mule stretcher or a gun shortener, so it's the only style I could think of with a short barrel where it'd look good.
In modern times, as well as in primitive times, you have to have three things for a fire. You have to have heat, fuel, and oxygen. Oxygen supplied by the air. The heat is going to be supplied by a steel and a flint. And the fuel is going to be supplied by char cloth. The char cloth is nothing more than partially burned cotton cloth. It has to be pure cotton. And what we want to do is we put the cloth on the flint, and as we strike the flint steel down the flint, it shaves off a small piece of the steel and turns it red hot, and that in turn falls into the cloth and will ignite it. And as you can see, it's just as fast as the modern lighters and matches. Once we have our char cloth burning, it will burn for quite some time. You can fold it into a little ball and blow on it. And we use what we call a tinder. A tinder is nothing more than a shredded vegetable matter of some kind. In this case, it's jute. In most cases, we use bark from a Jupiter tree and shred it up and pulverize it. Once you get your cloth inside the inside your tinder, you just start blowing until it comes into flame.
This gun, when I got finished with it, I put.
Had you put linseed oil?
Yeah, I put a coat of linseed oil on this after I boiled it and scrubbed it real good with hot soapy water. Then I put linseed on it to seal it. And I didn't like that the way it came out at first because it was real tacky And of course, when you, as soon as you get through building one, you want to hold it all the time. But finally it dried, and you can still see a little gloss to it. But I like the idea, the way it turned out after it finally dried, but it took several weeks for it to dry.
Well, when I built this rifle, I wanted it to be a plain Southern rifle, something that would have been from Virginia or North Carolina, Tennessee. And I ordered a piece of plain wood with no figure in it. And when I got the parts all in and started to rasp it into shape, all these little swirly figures started to come out. And then when the stain was put on, it really made all that quilting jump out. And I was just amazed that
you were disappointed you ordered a nice plain piece of wood and sent you that.
Yeah, I ordered a nice piece of plain, straight grain wood, and then it turned out with this.
I've been disappointed, but not in that direction.
People see it now and they think I gave it $100 for that wood when it was actually $8.
Most people think this is a cannon. They call it a cannon, and I guess technically it is, but it is referred to as a swivel gun because it swivels. And also a wall gun because they mounted them on the walls of a fort. They also used them, they called them punt guns, and the market hunters would put them on the front of a boat, and they could take out a lot of ducks because they were meat hunter. They did it for sale and to sell the meat. The reason I'm so interested in this is in our part of the world, up around Tecumseh, Washington Irving came through and wrote about his experiences. Josiah Gregg came through and he kept a journal, and he published that in the 1830s, and it covered a period of from 1820 to about 1827, I believe. Josiah Gregg was a trader, and he operated out of St. Louis, Missouri, and they would cut across Kansas and then cut south and go down into Taos and on into Chihuahua, Mexico. He figured out that he could save a month's time. He could start a month early by moving his operation to Fort Smith, Arkansas. And they angled to the southwest and got onto the, what we call the South Canadian. At that time it was the Canadian, and the North Canadian was the North Fork of the Canadian. And he would follow that down on land, just following the river, and then on into Taos and down to Chihuahua. And in his journals, he said that he carried two swivel guns. One was brass with a 1-inch bore, and one was steel with a 1.25-inch bore. And he said that they shot with surprising accuracy up to a mile. This is a 1-inch bore, and it's that would be a 100 caliber. It would also be called a quarter pounder because it shoots a quarter pound ball, or a 4-bore, meaning the 4 balls to the pound. But since you can call this a quarter pounder, well, I call it Big Mac.
This is an old original flint. It's made probably in about 1710 to 1720, maybe 1740. Probably South Carolina. And I had to refurbish the stock. It was kind of white looking and everything. And tried to make it back original as it could. It did not have a trigger guard, and I had to make a trigger guard that would fit it. Also a toe plate, I had to make the toe plate, and a little patch box deal here. It is a fired by flint, and it's an English lock. And there's not any American made lock that will even compete with it. It's faster, it's more positive. And there were a lot of English locks imported, and your better locks were flints.
Going to be making a nail here. That was a pretty common job for young apprentices, even household, kind of a cottage industry. All nails up till 1840 were handmade. They were expensive, hard to come by. A lot of towns, Philadelphia passed an ordinance banning people from burning down old buildings to salvage the nails. I get this up to heat. I'll start out by hammering it to a square point. take another heat, cut it off, and hammer the head out flat on it. Here you've got a finished nail. It'll be made with all sizes of heads, all lengths, sizes of shafts. Gives you good appreciation for a 50-pound box of nails nowadays.
And one thing that was really unique about the British Army is that they allowed their regiments to take a family with them. Each company was allowed to take six wives, and so that allowed 60 women to go on campaign with them. So when they left England and, let's say, came to America or something like that, they would have the provisions for that. But the only unfortunate part of it was is that normally it was only the officers and the sergeants of the regiments that had the wives, because the normal enlisted man, the privates, couldn't afford them, because they were only paid about 6 to 8 pence a day, which is the equivalent of about 25 to 50 cents a day today. And out of that money, he had to take and pay for food, clothing, and shelter, and everything else for his family. So needless to say, he didn't take his family with him very often. But I have my family here, and this is my wife, Betsy, and over back there is my two children, Shannon and Glenn. And Betsy goes on reenactments with us, and we also do rendezvous together and everything else. She's what would be dressed in the period costume of what a typical housewife or a camp follower would wear, with her pants, shoes, vest, and chemise. And our camp here is made up somewhat of what either a sergeant or an officer would have, with a wall tent, an awning, a few chairs. Every soldier had his own mess, where mess tin and cook kit, where he could cook his own meals and stuff. And the king was usually gracious enough to give them dried salt pork, dried beef, salt beef, some flour, peas, and that was his normal food that he would have for the day.
This is a plain style teepee we have over here. It's designed after a Sioux pattern. It's made out of canvas, naturally, since the buffalo are gone, and it's much easier to do. But it's one of the better tents to lay over hunt out of. It's all weather. As we come into the inside of the lodge, we'll start right here with this liner that's inside of it. It's very important. It's referred to as a dew cloth. And this keeps you drier when it rains. It also creates a draft for ventilation to draw the smoke out from the fireplace. And you also use the smoke flaps, adjust them from the outside to according to the direction of the wind. And that pulls the smoke out. It's not 100% smoke free, but it's livable. Then we got our dinner cooking over here in a pot. So as you notice, you can cook inside. You've got plenty of heat. If the weather gets a little bit too rough, well, it can all be done inside. It's a very efficient shelter for living or hunting either.